Hello and welcome to everyone joining today from around the world. It's great to have you here today on this Hayes LinkedIn live session. So today we wanted to run a live session for you focusing on how to best write or update your CV. We know that this is a challenge that many of you are facing at the moment, so we hope you'll find this session useful and productive and that you'll get some top tips to take away. My name is Karen Young and I'm a director for our Hayes UK and Ireland business. I have 24 years experience working in recruitment. And during those years, I've helped countless professionals create the best CV possible to ultimately help them secure a new role. And let me assure you that even though the world of work is changing at some pace, your CV or your resume is still your most important personal sales document. The prospect of writing or updating your CV can feel like a daunting task, I know that. So during this session, we'll go through each step with you and we'll cover what to think about actually before you begin the process. And you know, joining today is part of that. But the importance of taking a step back and really thinking about what it is that you want from a new role, whether that's going to be an internal or an external move. And then we'll go on to look at how best to structure your CV. Then we'll look at personal statement that really grabs the attention of the reader. And remember that in many cases, the person who is reading is the person making the hiring decision and who you may ultimately work for. So it's the one that you want to impress. And after that, we'll look at how to plot out your employment history in a clear and relevant way. And then we'll look at how you can bring your career achievements, really important, to life on your CV and really sell yourself as a candidate. And lastly, really important, we'll look at how you can try and avoid using those cliches, showcase your skills, and ensure that your CV is error-free. At the end of the presentation, we'll have a quick Q&A. So as we go through, do feel free to post your questions in the comments section on Facebook, on LinkedIn, YouTube, or tweet us, and we will get through as many as we can. For those questions that we don't get to, we will write and share a follow-up blog, and hopefully that will answer some of the questions that we don't manage to get to today. Throughout the session, I will aim to ensure the advice is as globally applicable as possible. However, there may be some variations in terms of what best practice does look like from country to country, and even what things get called. So CV and resume is a classic example. If you're looking for specific local advice, we do recommend that you contact your local Hayes office, and we'll provide a link in the comments section of the live session in order to help you with this. So before you start updating or writing your CV, it's really important that you think about the role that you're aspiring to get so that you're really clear in your mind what you're aiming for. Once you're clear on this, it will help you to one, better target your job search, which is really important, and two, you'll be better able to tailor your CV to align with this. And of course, that will improve your chances of being invited for interview. And let's face it, that's what the CV is all about. So on this slide, you can see a number of questions that we recommend that you ask yourself, and we'll go through each one. What are you looking for in your next job? Do you want to develop new skills? Perhaps you're keen to work in a specific industry or for a company that is more aligned with your core personal values. Think about what you've enjoyed in previous roles and consider what value you can bring to your desired role, and really think about what sets you apart from other candidates. Things like salary and benefits, we'd recommend researching benchmark salaries in your industry and profession, your role type, and you can use our Hayes salary guides to help you with this around the world, as well as speaking with local Hayes consultants. In terms of benefits, what you want may have changed as a result of the global pandemic, so do give this some thought. Many companies offer fantastic perks, could be company car, gym membership, private healthcare, charity volunteering days, well-being support, even more simple things like dress down days, but all of which help to make employees feel valued. So what do these benefits mean to you and what is important to you? Because it will be different from one person to another. And also bear in mind that organizations around the world will be currently reviewing their benefits packages too. An obvious example would be potential changes in the future to company vehicle offerings, if you may not need to travel quite so much for work in the future as more will be done remotely. How will you achieve your long-term career goals? Thinking about where you want to be in 5 or 10 years' time is certainly useful, but I also advocate thinking about what about the job, just the one after the next one, and where are your skills gaps? Where do you need to build up your experience? And what type of role would help you to plug those gaps? And remember, it doesn't always mean that you have to take a step up. You could consider a horizontal or a sideways move. And actually, I talk more about building up these different, what I call buckets of different skills in one of my own personal blogs. We'll make sure that we share this content for you too. And tied to the above, what technical and soft skills are you looking to develop? What would be most useful in helping you achieve your career goals? And what type of role and organization would support you in upskilling? The culture and work environment that you join is obviously really important. And do you enjoy working for a large organization, or would a smaller, fast and agile company suit you better? Would you sink or swim in a high pressurized, high stress environment, whether this be large, medium or small organization? Do you want to be customer facing or working on the inside? All of these are really important questions to consider. And also, of course, the impact of remote and hybrid working on this and your future roles. What are your deal breakers? We all have them, but they'll be different for everyone. It could be the commute time, and that will still exist for some of you, even now in the pandemic. And for many people, again, as we come out of the crisis, an organization's commitment to employee diversity and inclusion, a lack of opportunity to travel, or perhaps too much travel, limited promotional opportunities, for example. And on the flip side, think about the elements you think that you could be more flexible about in order to get the job that you really want, and those which you definitely aren't. Sometimes that step sideways, that sort of detour I mentioned, can lead to a really good step forwards in the long run. There's lots of other questions you could ask yourself to help ensure that before you start your job search process, before you begin updating your CV, you're really clear on what you're looking for. And as I said before, this will help you get your job search, it'll help you target your CV, increasing the chances that you'll be invited to interview. I know it's quite a bit of effort, it's quite a bit of thinking time before you even start the CV, but like anything, the planning will help you save time and help you be more effective in the long run. And it's great, obviously, that you're taking those first steps by joining us today. So now let's dive into the tips to help you best optimize your CV. I think it's helpful to start with the structure of the document. And of course, it's important to note that in some countries, the actual order of the CV will be different to others. And some sections aren't always relevant in different geographies. For example, I know that the personal statement isn't needed so much in Germany, for example. But in general, your CV should include 8 key specific sections. Your name and contact details. Now, we won't go into this in too much detail on this session. It should be quite straightforward. But ensure that you include your key contact details, that they're correct and that they're up to date. Your email address is professional sounding and also one that you are going to access regularly. There's no point providing an email address that you barely check daily. If you do, you might miss out on an interview. And I've had that happen to people. There's no need to list your date of birth or your gender here. And in most cases around the world, a photo isn't needed. And you may find it hard to believe, but over the years, I have received some CVs where people have worked really hard on the content and they've actually forgotten to put their name on the top. So don't forget the simple things too. Your personal statement, this is a summary of your career history and more importantly, a succinct explanation of why you're the right person for the job you've applied for, and I'll come back to this later. Your employment history, details of your work history, including paid work, placements, volunteering, and your achievements, a list of your relevant achievements, which clearly highlight your suitability for the role that you're applying for. Continuing on then, summary of your skills, brief list of your skills, focusing on those that are most relevant to the roles that you're interested in, and also would include potentially professional qualifications for here. For example, if you're a chartered surveyor, you're a qualified accountant. Educational background, any relevant information on relevant training courses or qualifications. Won't go into that in too much detail today, but we'll touch on it when we talk through your skills summary. And again, hobbies and interests. We won't cover it too much today. The section can be really brief on your CV, but I do believe it does help to show your personality and often transferable skills. And it helps to show you're a real person, which matters. And lastly, your references. In most geographies, there's no need to provide contact details for references until they've been requested by the employer, potential employer, as part of an interview and offer process. So good practice is just to add references are available on request that you can see on the screen in front of you. So we'll go through most of these sections during the session. And as I said at the start, do feel free to post any questions you have. We'll aim to answer those at the end or via a follow-up blog. So next on to how to write your personal statement, because this does generally come after those contact details on your CV. And for those of you that aren't entirely sure what this personal statement is all about, it's essentially a few lines explaining who you are as a professional and why you are right for the role you've applied for. It's often the first thing the recruiter or hiring manager will read on your CV. So it's really worth putting in the effort to ensure that it resonates with them, and importantly, that it encourages them to find out more about you. Structure-wise, best to structure into three sections to make sure that it's succinct and it delivers impact, and the impact, importantly, that you're looking for. So firstly, to introduce yourself, the first thing the reader wants to know when reading your personal statement is who you are and what level of experience that you have. So an example, I'm a hands-on finance manager with strong stakeholder engagement skills and a results-driven attitude. Next, you'd be listing your skills and experience. So you must outline your key skills and evidence your key achievements that set you apart from the competition. And it's really important that you keep this section relevant. I do use that word a lot, I'm very aware, by identifying the desired skills and the attributes that are in the job and person specification that you're applying for, that you're interested in. And you ensure that the skills that you choose to highlight, and I do use the word choose, are in your personal statement and that they mirror what's on that job and person specification. And now you go on to provide evidence of your skills through some specific results. And the list of highlights will have so much more impact if they are related to the key requirements of the vacancy and backed up by fact. So for example, with 6 years experience, I'm able to increase visibility within a business, drive efficiencies and implement cost saving measures that increase profits. And lastly, explain your ambitions for the future. Finish by outlining what you're looking to achieve next in your career and make sure that it's relevant and links to the role in question. The hiring manager needs to know that your ambitions are relevant to the opportunity and that you would therefore be driven and likely to succeed. So how would I draw on the example here? I would now like to develop my skills in a global business environment where I can progress my career within accountancy. So the full personal statement in this case, as I've built it, would read, I'm a hands-on finance manager with strong stakeholder engagement skills and a results-driven attitude. With 6 years industry experience, I'm able to increase visibility within a business, drive efficiencies and implement cost-saving measures that increase profits. I'd now like to develop my skills in a global business environment where I can progress my career within accountancy. So now that you know what needs to be included in your personal statement, I thought it'd be helpful to run through a few do's and don'ts. Do include plenty of what I call action verbs, and these will really help you to evidence your achievements. So for example, to demonstrate your creativity, words like built and crafted, devised, implemented, pioneered, initiated, established. Efficiency, you can see, advanced, capitalized, maximized, leveraged, improved. To demonstrate leadership skills, coordinated, executed, managed, led, organized. And do make sure that you incorporate specific keywords from the job descriptions of your ideal roles. This will help relevancy for the reader and try to tailor your personal statement for the role that you're applying for. How long should it be? Best to try to keep your personal statement to about 150 to 200 words. It should be easier now you know what to include and what to omit. Plus a sort of structure. But if you find yourself writing over 200 words, have a second look, check it back and check that you can relate all your points back to the job vacancy that you're applying for and showcasing why you're the right person for the job. Other things, try not to switch or don't switch between the first and third person. In your personal statement, you can use the third person or first person narrative. And an example of third person language is she can or he can, whereas first person would be I can. Just be sure to choose one over the other and to keep this consistent from the beginning of your personal statement right up until the end. Personally, I much prefer first person narrative. It feels more personal. It's not gender specific. And quite frankly, it's human because you're describing yourself. But again, you can check with local best practice via a Hayes recruiting expert. The power of this personal statement, you shouldn't underestimate. It's your chance to sell the core aspects of yourself as a candidate, particularly your experience, your level of expertise, your achievements, and really importantly, your future ambitions. So next, after your personal statement, are you going to plot out your career or your employment history in chronological order, starting with your most recent role? And format each entry within this consistently, outlining the job title, the company, the dates you were employed there. If you're currently working, you add your start date and add the word current or to date and your key responsibilities and achievements. Where possible, avoid leaving gaps here. For instance, those that may have come about by full-time study, redundancy, traveling, caring responsibilities. The list is endless how gaps do appear on a CV, and it's quite normal. You're not alone. If you're unemployed for a period of time, briefly explain how you made use of the time, for example. That could be studying further, upskilling, job searching, traveling, for example. But whatever your reasons, I do advocate that you be as transparent as possible. And within each area of your employment history, focus on the value you added, not what your duties were. And if any of your roles were temporary, it's good to say so. It's also a good idea, as we explained in the personal statement section, to incorporate relevant keywords from the job description onto your employment history. And I'd also recommend adding more detail to the roles in your career history that are most relevant to that which you're applying for. And that often is the most recent job or your current job, but it might be that one job before last was really relevant. So that's where you'd spend a bit more time. So to finish this section on how to plot out your career history, let's have a look at an example that you can see on the screen in front of you. So we've got finance manager, you'd insert your company name, July 2018, I'm finishing the job, I've just finished it in January 2021. And you can see there executed long and short-term financial strategies enabling the organization to reach its commercial growth objectives of XYZ. Employed advanced analysis in comprehensively reviewing market trends and making informed recommendations for future revenue streams, contributing to an increase in gross profit of XYZ, guided, motivated and supported the P&L team in the optimization of monthly management accounts and producing accurate analytical reports for internal stakeholders. So someone could have put this here as their duties, and that may have read something more like preparing monthly management accounts, preparing the P&L, planning and managing budgets and analysis. And I know I'm using a finance specific example, but hopefully you can see the difference between what would be duties and responsibilities and achievements and how much more impact you can have when you use action verbs and relate it to achievements in your role rather than just listing kind of what's on your job spec. Once you've plotted this section out, you're really ready to bring your experience and your achievements to life with the language that you use, and you can decide whether to plot a handful of your most significant achievements per recent role, or bring them together under a section that you specifically note as key achievements that provides more of a career summary, if you will. Personally, and it is personal, I generally advocate writing it in this style for each of your most recent roles. But again, it's worth checking this with your local HAYS consultant within your country. So how can you bring your experience to life in the employment history section of your CV? Mentioned it in the personal statement section, but I wanted to reiterate the importance of using action verbs here. I talked about creativity and using the words like built and devised and implemented. We spoke about the leadership skills and the efficiency bit. To demonstrate improvements made, using words like refined, remodeled, strengthened, upgraded, transformed. And really important on the improvements bit, because most organizations, you know, in today's age and sometimes as a result of the global pandemic, they're looking to see how you manage change and how you can see projects through. So I would say improvements made is a really important section of your CV. Also, as opposed to writing that you've got good organization skills, you could try using words like facilitated or programmed or arranged. And rather writing that I always achieve my goals, you could write reached or surpassed or accomplished. It's wordplay, but using these different choice of words really helps to avoid your CV sounding cliched. And you stand out as expert, you stand out as authentic, and most importantly, the best match for the job to get you that interview, which I will keep saying is the purpose of your CV. So as I mentioned, it's important that you do replace these cliches. We see an awful lot of CVs at HAYS around the world on a day-to-day basis, and the action verbs that you use can emphasize your skills, cliches will dilute them. So make sure that you can use quantifiable language to give further weight to your skills and experience. So what are common things that we see? What are the common cliches? Works well independently. If working independently is a genuine strength of yours, then give an example of a time that you showcased this strength and the results. For instance, I independently developed a new strategy that increased customer engagement by X%. It's a far more effective way to demonstrate that skill. What else? A great team player. Stand out from the competition by providing evidence that you can work well with colleagues or external stakeholders to reach a common goal. So an example would be, I worked with our international and local marketing teams to implement a global rebrand across 12 countries. Results driven. Instead of simply stating you are results driven, support the claim with facts and ensure that you give quantifiable evidence of your results. So, for example, you know, I increased sales by 25%. You're pretty results driven. And you can see some more examples here, a hard worker. So rather than use that, prove that your productivity and your work ethic and your time management skills are there by giving examples. So, for example, creating a successful product launch in a short time frame or never missing a deadline in 2 years in your last role. Good communication skills. I think this is on almost everyone's CV. Be more specific by giving examples of situations in which your communication skills have really shone through, such as a presentation or sales pitch you gave which won a new client for your business. And a fast learner, if you really want to demonstrate your aptitude in this area, you need to put your money where your mouth is. So describe a time when you grasped a new concept really quickly. Next, it's time to draft your skills summary, a bulleted list of your skills which relate to the role that you're applying for. These skills and also relevant professional qualifications can also be referenced in your personal statement and sometimes in the employment history section of your CV. And again, they should include the keywords you've picked out from the job description. Remember that you need to include both the technical or hard skills or soft and the soft skills. So it's probably best if we have a look at some examples of each. So technical skills are the skills which you've gained throughout your professional career, which you've learned, which are either required or desirable for the role. So I've tried to pick a number of things that cross different professions, from coding in tech to proficiency in foreign languages to data analysis to budget work. Could be HTML, it could be CAD drawing, it could be that you're a specialist in employment law. Project management with accreditations like Six Sigma or PRINCE2 methodology. And it can also include technical skills too, like your proficiency in, I'll pick Microsoft Office, for example. But that gives you kind of an idea of the technical skills. The soft skills, or as I prefer to call them, competencies, are your personal attributes that allow you to work well with others and achieve your goals. And some you will have inherently, some will also have been learned and developed over your career. But classic ones, communication, decision-making, time management. You can see them on the screen in front of you. Conflict resolution, problem-solving, business acumen. As the world of work is changing, some of the competencies employers are looking for are adapting and changing. And competencies like creativity, social dynamics, cognitive and critical thinking, and the ability to work independently are on the rise. Many were anyway. But the global pandemic, I think, has certainly accelerated employers' need to hire more people with these abilities. And employers are certainly asking us at Hays, if I'm going to have someone working in this role that may need to work remotely some or all of the time, how do I look for what I need? How do I assess these type of competencies? So you certainly want to be thinking about that as well and how you get these newer competencies and soft skills onto your CV. And if you're getting stuck at this stage, think about the transferable skills that you may have learned in previous roles, or indeed many of you may have been studying more recently and looking for your first professional experience on your CV, and we're here to help. So for instance, you might have honed your listening skills at university. Think about a time when you've taken upon it yourself to upskill in any way. So you might have taught yourself, how to use WordPress when you're writing a personal blog. And now onto the final section of my presentation, ensuring that your CV is error-free. You've come this far, you've worked really hard to craft the perfect CV, so don't undersell yourself by forgetting to proofread it properly. Despite the fact that you may think it's perfect, the chances are that there's something to work on. So let's look at some of the most common CV errors to look out for. Spelling mistakes and grammatical errors. Please do use the spell checking software on your computer and ensure it's set to the correct language for where you are. Print off your CV once and or cover letter. You will find it easier to pick up on mistakes. And read your CV aloud. Again, it can help to highlight any glaring errors to you. This is a bit of an odd one, but if you read your CV backwards, it's a proven way to pick up errors. You might see something wrong in your date ranges, for example. And for me, one of the most important is asking someone else, a friend, a relative, someone to proofread it for you. It's a must, because however good you think you are at proofreading, trust me, we look at tens of thousands of CVs every day at Hays, and there's more mistakes than you would believe that there would be. A lack of consistency, ensure you're consistent in your use of abbreviations and capitalizations, and also beware using internal abbreviations and jargons from within your current or previous organizations. This can make it quite hard to understand your CV and quite off-putting if they're not known in the outside world. So a bit of a sense check on that's quite important. And then consistently using the same simple font, how it looks and font size throughout your CV and application. Same goes for using bold text or any text in italics. And don't switch from writing in the first person to the third person that we spoke about earlier, and vice versa. Pick one and stick with it, whatever you're most comfortable with. And similarly, just making sure that you're maintaining a professional tone throughout. And then lastly, formatting issues, keeping it really simple. Avoid the temptation to get carried away using different backgrounds, borders. I remember once receiving a CV in the post, actually, in my earlier years as a recruiting expert, and it came on red paper. It was an attempt to stand out, but it didn't get attention really for the right reasons. And instead, I spent quite a lot of time with the individual working on the content of the CV, and thankfully they went back to normal white paper. If using Word, zoom out of the document to get a clearer view of your formatting. And again, just carefully you print the document out once to quickly flag formatting errors. That way you'll soon see if something doesn't look quite right. And ultimately, whilst a lot of CVs will be reviewed digitally these days, the chances are that if you're having an interview, the interviewer will print the CV out so they can write notes easily, and that will make it easier for your interviewer to have a good experience. And ultimately, that's what you want them to have. If your CV is more than one page, which it absolutely can be, ensure that your page transitions are smooth. So try not to start a sentence on one page that then carries on to the next. And if you're struggling for space, don't be tempted to reduce the margins to nothing and the font to something like size 6. It might help you get more words on the page, but it doesn't help the reader if they are squinting to see the content. And remember, white space can definitely be your friend. Once you're happy with the formatting, you're happy with everything, try converting the document into PDF. And that should mean then that your formatting stays as you intended it when you send it over for your job application to the recruiter or the hiring manager. And then the last check is make sure that it reads well on a desktop, a mobile, and a tablet, as these days your reader could be printing it off, but they are likely to be accessing it from any one of those options, and sometimes obviously whilst on the move. So that brings me to the end of my presentation. I hope you've picked up some good tips and that you can now take some time to reflect on your CV and consider making some changes, even if they are small tweaks at this stage. Small things can make big differences. And as I said at the start, your CV or your resume is your most important personal sales document as it stands today. So do make time to get it right. And now I think with some time to take a few questions, I think I saw that we had some coming through during the session. Okay, so question one, good question. What's the difference between my CV and my LinkedIn profile? It's a really good question, and I do get asked this a lot. First off, think about which one does the recruiter assess first, your CV or your LinkedIn profile? And the answer to that does depend on how you're applying for a job. So for example, if the initial job application didn't require you to submit a CV, so you might be using something like LinkedIn Easy Apply, for example, then your recruiter may search for you on LinkedIn first after receiving your application. And alternatively, your recruiter may find you on LinkedIn because even though you haven't actively applied for a job with them, you match their criteria for a job that they're recruiting for. On the other hand, if you register with a recruiter or you're applying for a job, whether it's through a job board, recruitment website, LinkedIn, or even directly with an organization, you'll be using your CV. So my view would be your CV is still the main means of applying for a job, and it should serve the purpose of giving the recruiter, the reader, a factual and chronological snapshot of your skills and experience to date. And the recruiter will need to know that you are both interested in and suitable for the job specifically. So your CV will always need a little bit more tailoring than your generic LinkedIn profile. It's really, really important that you adapt your CV each time you apply to a job. It should probably never go off exactly the same if you're doing your job properly. So you can do that by following some of the points that we've covered in the session in terms of tweaking your personal statement to mirror some of those keywords in the person and job description, and streamlining your skills and experience. But largely, you won't be tweaking your LinkedIn profile too much all of the time, but you can with your CV. The other difference probably with LinkedIn, you've got, because it's visual, because it's quite flexible, because it's interactive, you can bring your skills and experience to life in a slightly different way, telling more of a story about who you are. You can link video, you can link blogs, you can link projects that you've been or are currently involved with, for example. So it can be nice and interactive. You can't do that with a CV. And of course, a strong LinkedIn profile can enhance your chances of being approached by a recruiter first. Some of you will know that advanced data analytics skills are helping us to find and engage with people, whether they're looking for a job or they've just got a good profile. So you can get noticed by the right people. And we've actually got quite a few tips on how to do that, which we can share with you afterwards. But on a LinkedIn profile, I would absolutely advocate you do have an up-to-date and professional headshot photo. That's certainly one difference. And you've got a chance to put like a headline on LinkedIn that sums you up as a bit of a strap line. So ambitious IT sales professional with a passion for cloud computing, 3 years experience in this sector. So you can really kind of optimize that. So CVs are still the most important personal sales document. I stand by that when it comes to getting a job. But it should be complemented by a really strong LinkedIn profile. My final just point on that before we take another question is the one thing your CV does have in common with LinkedIn is the consistency that you need to show. So things like dates. I tend to find that people put quite a lot of time into preparing their CV, but maybe put their LinkedIn profile on in not so much time. And you don't want to have an employer comparing the two, your CV and your LinkedIn profile, and doubting your claim to have attention to detail and accuracy, by your dates not matching up on when you were employed, for example. So hopefully that answers the question. Next question, please. Okay, so how should I cover any gaps on my CV? Maybe that came up a little bit earlier in the session and hopefully I've touched on it, but as I've explained, most people have some form of gap on their CV. It could be redundancy, caring, traveling, education, you name it. And it's just important that you acknowledge and account for those gaps, really. There's no need to conceal anything. Add the dates and a short explanation to the employment history section, which is where your date chronological area is on your CV. There's no need to go into specifics. What's important is you explain as well how you were using your time proactively and productively for personal development during that time as well. So in the case of redundancy, that might be some courses that you took to upskill, for example. And you could also briefly explain a gap in your personal statement if you feel necessary, but succinctly and not drawing away from the other areas that we covered on personal statement. And succinctly, there's no need for war and peace in that section. Next question, please. Okay, so how do I write a strong CV if I don't have much experience? I actually spend quite a lot of time helping people with this as I run a future of finance program in the UK, so helping undergraduates with their sort of future choices if they're looking to become an accountant. So it's a really common challenge. And I would advise you include all your past experience, actually, even if it's not relevant to the job that you're applying for. So that could be volunteer work. It could be a part-time job you had while studying, because all of these roles will still help you to demonstrate things like your work ethic and your employability, teamwork and communication skills. And as we've discussed, it's about listing your experience in chronological order, always starting with your most recent role and including as much as you can around organisation name, what you were doing for them and the dates. And underneath that, just writing a couple of lines detailing your role and a bulleted list there, trying to think about sort of achievement-led writing rather than just a list of duties and responsibilities. And if you can link to online examples of your work, that could work here too, depending on what you do as a profession. But your personal statement here is a really great place to explain why you're applying for a particular role. Because if you haven't got much professional experience to touch on, you can use this area to really introduce yourself and explain how your interests and your academic and your employment background, your key skills are really relevant to the role that you're applying for. So an example might be, I'm a history graduate with a keen interest in pursuing a sales career, for example. So during my degree, I was largely graded on my presentation skills, and this was an area in which I scored very highly. And I also held a part-time job as a retail assistant during studying. And during this time, I enjoyed developing my interpersonal skills and customer services skills. And I would really like to apply my communicative and interpersonal skills to a more challenging sales role where I'd have room to grow and develop as a professional. So hopefully you can see there how I've drawn that together. And don't forget about your skills summary, because you might think that you don't have many relevant skills to include, but you will have a lot of transferable skills that are worth highlighting. So the history degree I just mentioned, listening skills, writing essays, you'll have developed some strong writing and presentation skills through that. And soft skills, these are the ones that really can't be taught. You'd be naturally well organized and a problem solver. So reflect on the things that people have praised you for in the past, whether that's teachers, tutors, friends, family. You can also take some online free online aptitude tests to discover more of your core strengths as well. And you can also use the additional information to the end of your CV as well, which could include kind of other qualifications that don't clearly belong in other sections of your CV. To add value here. Okay, next question, please. Oh gosh, right, okay. So the reverse then, in terms of how do I streamline my CV if I have a lot of experience? Well, it's a nice problem to have, but it can be a difficult one. And I know with my 24 years of recruitment experience, when I last looked at my own CV, I had to do some streamlining. So make sure that what you're looking at is how to optimize the most relevant information so it stands out to the recruiter or the hiring manager, as opposed to getting lost in reams of job titles and skills and qualifications and experience. So my frank advice is, if you've got a lot of experience, you're going to have to be ruthless. You're going to have to eliminate the information that just isn't relevant to the role that you're applying for. So highlight the key skills and attributes that are in the person and job description. Sit with a highlighter pen if you need to. Then look at your career history, and have you used up really valuable space describing things that are just not mentioned in that person and job description? Because if so, for the purpose of tailoring your CV, this job application, take them out. There's also probably no need to include your very early education or your very first job, on your CV, and making sure obviously that it's as current as possible, not sort of barking back to sort of distant past when you were a different person with probably less to offer at the time. And writing your CV with your target in mind, as an experienced, more senior level job seeker, that's what you've got to do, rather than bombarding with everything that you've ever done. So, all the things that we've talked about in terms of your personal statement, making sure that it's notable achievements you've had. So if you're applying for a marketing director position, you might mention the time you helped increase revenue at a specific company by implementing a campaign which involved X, Y, and Z, and giving the readers numbers and hard facts. It's a really good way to highlight your achievements as well. And I think in terms of language and format, you've just got to really work on the wordplay, not using 10 words to say something that you could say in 5. So using those action verbs, avoiding blocks of copy, it will put the reader off. Your CV needs to be easy to read, easy to follow, some white space around it, no matter how much experience that you have. And as I said before, avoid using the kind of company specific terminology. And in terms of your career history, you're going to be putting it in reverse chronological order, listing your most current role at the top. Make sure that that is very achievements driven. And if there's any other relevant position, most relevant position in your chronological history, make that achievement driven. If a previous job was completely irrelevant to the role that you're applying for, but you don't want to put a gap on your CV, just simply list your job title, the dates, and the company you worked for. It's going to save you space on your CV and ensure that the most relevant is up front and center on page 1 and where applicable, your top part of page 2 before you you then sense check it all back against that job description. Okay, how are we doing on time? Next question, please. How long should my CV be? I guess I just slightly referenced that there. It really depends on your experience. So, you know, there's a lot of old CV rules around the world. People talk about a one-page CV summary. That's great if you can do it. The main thing is making sure that you are able to portray all the skills and the experience and the achievements throughout your CV appropriately for the position that you're applying for. If you can do that well in one page, then one page is great. Personally, I'm a strong advocate of a two to three page CV. A lot of people talk about two pages. I don't actually get too hung up on that, but you will want to check with your local HAYS expert as well around what best practice is in your part of the world. If it's two pages is good, if it's running on to three, you wouldn't guess the longest CVs I've opened in my career. So I'll tell you, I think 17 pages was one of the worst culprits. And I can tell you that when people read a document, they read all the way down to the bottom of the first page of your CV or any document. They read about halfway down on the second page, and they'll probably speed read a few lines at the top of the third page. So if you are going on to three, you've got to make sure that that's more of the information that is references available on request. It's not the key power stuff of your personal statement, your most recent role, and the things that are relevant. You've got to have real impact on page one and the top part of page two for me. Hopefully that helps. And I think due to time, we're going to have to move to take a final question. We've got, how often should I update my CV? Okay. I know that people put these away in drawers, so to speak, and maybe only look at changing jobs every few years. But even if you aren't actively looking for a new job, it's really important to try and build a habit of regularly updating your CV. So if you've learned a new skill, if you've done a new course, if you've successfully completed a big project in your current role, and let's face it, as many of us are doing that, make sure that you get into your CV, you know where you've saved it, you know what your passwords are, and you update your CV to reflect it. Even if you don't get it to the finished article at that point, but you type in something to remind you that that's what you need to add in there when you're honing it for job applications, either internal or external. And like I've said throughout, it's really important that you quantify your achievements, as we've explored in the session, really. Those measurable results will really help to bring the potential to life for the reader. And it's also a really good idea to obviously update your LinkedIn profile at the same time. And I do tend to find these days sometimes people update their LinkedIn profile with something like a project or a course or a job change faster than they update your CV. But as we said on, I think, the first question that I took, your CV is still probably your most important personal sales document from a job application perspective. If you've got it up to date, when you do come to the point that you need it, there's no risk that you'll forget key points of your experience and achievements, and you'll be ready to go faster should you need it. So keep it as a work in progress document, you know, all of the time. Okay, so I think that brings us to the end of the session now. Seems to have sped by, but we hope you found it a useful tool and refresher, and that it helps you in your job search. If you'd like to rewatch the session, the recording will be available across our social media channels. And we also do have a full version of our CV guide at HAYS, which is available at content.hays.com/CV-guide/. We will also be following up on any questions we didn't get to, and I think there were quite a few. Do keep an eye out there for a blog that we'll produce at social.hays.com and in the comments section too. Once you think you've got your CV job application ready, feel free to sense check it, find your local HAYS website, register it with us, and we'll add a link into the chat function now on how to do that. Online registration is really quick and simple. It takes under a minute, and you can set up job alerts as well and manage your applications. Even if you're not looking currently for a new role, why wouldn't you want to keep up to date with what the market's doing and look at some of these things I've mentioned that are changing in terms of competencies? What's changing in your world, in your profession, in your job role, and what employers are starting to ask for on competencies? Because you can then get ahead, can't you, and do some kind of skills analysis and work out how you need to upskill before you make that next important job application. And once you've registered your CV, one of our expert recruiters will be in contact They can help you sense check it, as well as talk to you about your current career situation and provide you with latest opportunities within your area of expertise and your preferred locations. So all that remains is to say thank you very much for watching and joining us today. Best of luck with crafting your great CV. Go and make it count, and all the best with your future career moves. Thank you very much and goodbye.